All right, if you have your Bibles, I invite you to open up your copy of God's book to the book of Revelation, chapter 13. Revelation chapter 13. The title of this meeting is on the screen, and it's called America in Bible Prophecy. Move this out of the way. I'll be walking around a little bit today, and I don't want to have to run into anything. A lot of people study prophecy, but there's not a lot of people that really think America is in God's Word. And so today we're going to look at that. Is the greatest nation on earth pinpointed in the Bible? Is America there? Are we there? Well, we'll find out. So let's begin with prayer. Thank you. Okay, are you ready to pray? Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, dear God, Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we come to you and we ask that you will be with us as we open the Bible and as we look at prophecy. As we try to understand more about what is happening in our world and what the future holds, we pray for your blessing. Please help me. Please help us all and those that are watching on the internet. May the Holy Spirit talk to every one of us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. All right. America in Bible Prophecy. The year was 1995. I was giving a seminar in the state of Washington, not too far from Vancouver, Washington. And I was driving back and forth to those meetings. And as I was driving back and forth, it was hard to miss it. On the horizon, there was a mountain that was looming off in the distance. Mount St. Helens. Have you ever seen that mountain? It's an awesome sight to really look at it. It's amazing. Mount St. Helens is actually a volcano. And in the year 1980, that volcano became active. It began to spurt. It began to sputter. It began to smoke. And for the next 2 months, people that were living anywhere close to that mountain were warned to leave the area. You've got to get out. This mountain is about to blow. People were told. Well, there was one particular man whose name has rather become famous, at least in the area of Mount St. Helens. His name was Harry Truman, not our former president, but another Harry Truman. And he lived right at the base of the mountain. And he was just a diehard stalwart that there's no way I'm leaving my home. And he was told, Harry, you've got to get out of here. This mountain's going to blow. But he didn't believe it. Or he thought if it did happen, that he would be fine. Well, eventually that mountain did explode, and nobody ever found Harry Truman's body. It's probably somewhere at the bottom of Spirit Lake, right next to the mountain, covered in trees and debris and whatever else. But that man chose not to take warning. This morning, we are going to study another mountain. I like to call it Mount Revelation 13. Mount Revelation 13. And we are going to see clearly that this mountain is spurting and sputtering. It's smoking big time. And my conviction is that this mountain is about to explode in the final fulfillment of Bible prophecy that has been predicted in this chapter. And God wants us to take warning. He wants us to learn the lessons as we look at this chapter. He wants us to take his word very, very seriously and to prepare what is coming, for what is coming. We don't want to be like Harry Truman, do we? That when this mountain goes off and Bible prophecy, the final prophecies are fulfilled in that chapter, you know, that we are taken unawares. Like Harry Truman. the Bible talks about in the book of Revelation that those who eventually get the mark of the beast will end up in the lake of fire. And I don't want to go there. I don't want to end up in the lake of fire. I don't want my family to end up in the lake of fire. I don't want you to end up in the lake of fire. And I don't think you want to be there either, right? So let's study our Bibles. How does that sound? Let's study Revelation chapter 13. If you have your Bible, open up Revelation chapter 13. We are going to start with the 11th verse. We're going to really dissect this verse. 13:11. 13:11. The Bible says, John, who looked off into the future, this is what he said. And I beheld, as he received this vision from Jesus, I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. And he had two horns like a lamb, and he spoke like what kind of an animal? He spoke like a dragon. That's right. Now there it is. There's a verse in Revelation 13:11. That verse is inspired by God. That verse is a very mysterious verse. Does this verse have anything to do with the United States of America? Well, we're going to find out today. We're going to study this. Study it very carefully. Now, as we looked at last night, one of the most important questions that we need to ask and answer before we can really go anywhere with Revelation is, what is a beast in prophecy? What is a beast? John said, I saw a beast, another beast coming up. So what is a beast? So just very quickly, let me just review just a little bit of what we did last night. Last night, we talked about how Revelation 13 ties in with Daniel chapter 7. Most of you were here. Daniel 7 and Revelation 13 go right together. Both chapters talk about a lion, a bear, a leopard, a dragon, 10 horns, a mouth, war on the saints. Point by point, these two chapters go together. Last night, we looked at Daniel 7, verse 23, where an angel explained to Daniel exactly what a beast represents in prophecy so that we don't have to guess. We can know for sure. The angel said that the fourth beast shall be the fourth what? The fourth kingdom upon the earth. Right, that a beast in prophecy represents a kingdom or a great nation. A beast is a kingdom. And last night I talked about how the first beast in Daniel 7, the lion, was Babylon, followed by Persia, followed by Greece, followed by the Roman Empire. The great, mighty Roman Empire. And I went down through the history. I'm not going to review all of that. If you were here last night, you remember. And if you weren't, then just take the word from the Bible that a beast represents a great nation. Now, if we go back to Revelation 13, which parallels Daniel 7, just point by point by point by point, those chapters go right together like a lock and a key. Here we go back to 13:11, and the Bible says, I saw another beast, a new beast, coming up out of the earth with two horns like a lamb, and he spoke as a dragon. Now, what did we learn a beast represents? Right, a beast is not a computer, it's not a man, it's not any one of a number of things that people often speculate. A beast, according to Bible prophecy, is a kingdom or a great nation. So, John looked ahead down the stream of time and he saw another nation. And the scripture says that this nation would be coming up at a certain point in time. Now, approximately when does this nation come up? Does it come up in ancient history like Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome? Or does it come up down near the end of time? If we look at verse 16, we have an answer to that. Revelation 13:16 says that this same beast would eventually cause all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. And that's what I'll talk about this afternoon at 3:30. That no man might buy or sell, save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Now, here's a quiz question. Is the mark of the beast something that comes up, you know, way back in history during the time of Babylon, Persia, Greece, or Rome? Is the mark of the beast something that, you know, came up during European history way a long time ago? No, the mark of the beast is something that occurs down at the very end of time. Isn't that right? It hasn't happened yet. It's still coming. It's ahead of us before Jesus comes. And so based on that, we can put pieces together and know that this beast in Revelation 13:11 comes up somewhere down near the end of time. He's in place. He's fully active at the time when the mark of the beast is enforced. That's our context. So we really have, we have an end time nation, not a nation from ancient days. We know that that's when he comes up, down near the end of time, and he's active at the end of time. Now, here's another fact about this beast. This is I consider this to be prophetic intelligence information. You know, American intelligence, you know, they're the CIA and different agents are scattered around the world trying to gather information for our government. Well, God also has intelligence information that he has given us in his Bible. And this little piece that this nation comes out of the earth is a very significant piece of information. Now, if you remember, I don't know how many of you have studied Daniel 7, but we talked about this again last night in Daniel 7, verse 3, that the four beasts that Daniel saw in his dream, Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome, they came up out of a certain location. And where was that location? The verse is on the screen. That's right. These four beasts, the earlier beasts, it says they came up from the sea, whereas the beast in Revelation 13:11, he comes up out of the earth. Now, is there any significance to that? Those beasts come out of the sea, the other beast comes out of the earth. Are those, just pieces of information that have no relevance? Or are those prophetic pieces of intelligence information that have very important lessons for us? I believe so. I believe that's the case. Now, turn to Revelation chapter 17, and let's find out what the waters represent. What are the waters? What does this represent? We don't have to guess. Just like Daniel 7 tells us exactly what a beast is, so Revelation chapter 17 tells us exactly what the water represents. In chapter 17, verse 1, John saw a woman. There came one of the seven angels who had the seven vials who talked with me, and he said to me, come hither, and I will show you the judgment of the great whore who sits. And where does she sit? She sits on many waters, the Bible says. And then John saw this woman. Verse 5 describes her, and her name is Babylon, Mystery Babylon. This woman, which we'll talk more about later, this Mystery Babylon woman is sitting upon this beast with seven heads and 10 horns, and she is riding upon the waters. Now, what do the waters represent? The answer to that, I think some of you know that, the answer is found in verse 15. We do not have to guess. Just like in Daniel 7, verse 23, God tells us that a beast represents a nation. We don't have to guess. It's the same in chapter 17, verse 15. God tells us what the waters represent. And so take a look at the verse, and it will tell us. Here is an angel now talking to John, who wrote this book. He said to me, the waters which you saw where the whore sits. See that? There's the Babylonian woman sitting upon the waters. And the angel says that the waters are, which means they represent, they are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. See that? So the water in prophecy represents lots and lots and lots of people, nations of people, multitudes of people. And if you go back into ancient history, you learn that Babylon, Persia, Greece, and Rome, they rose up out of a sea of different kinds of people that were in Europe and the Middle East. They rose up right in the middle of all these different nations and people and tongues and kings. So that's what the waters represent. But when we go to Revelation 13, verse 11, this new beast, this another beast, the Bible says, that comes up down the stream of time and is eventually very active when the mark of the beast is enforced. This beast comes up out of the earth. Now, if the water represents lots of people, multitudes of people, nations of people, all different kinds of people, then what would the earth represent? Okay, I'm hearing different ideas. The earth would represent an area that's a lot more sparsely populated, that doesn't have a lot of nations. Now, there might be some people there, and there were some people, but there were not the amount of people that we find in Europe and the Middle East. It was much more of a wilderness type of an area where this second beast would come up out of the earth. Now, there's a lot more little pieces of information for us. And then it says, not only would he come up out of the earth, but how many horns would he have? Go back to Revelation 13:11, and it says that he would have two horns. Two horns. See that? Two horns like a lamb. Now, that's significant. Two horns like a lamb. Now, I want you to notice something about those horns, and that is they're just horns. They don't have anything on top of them. Now, if you go back in your Bibles to verse 1, Revelation 13:1, it talks about the first beast. There's actually two beasts in Revelation. There's the first beast and then the second beast. This is the second beast. The first beast is described in verse 1, and this beast also has horns, but there's something on those horns. 13:1 says, I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea. This beast comes out of the sea, not the earth. And he has 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns were 10 what? 10 crowns. That's right. Here's that other beast, and this other beast has crowns upon his horns. Now, last night I spent over an hour studying what the Bible says, what Revelation 13 says, what Daniel 7 says, putting these chapters together. And if you weren't here, sorry, but I built my case that first beast is a symbol of the Church of Rome, the Roman Church. And it's significant that that church, which grew up and actually became a kingdom, which now has ambassadors to embassies around the world and to nations around the world, this first beast is described as a beast with horns, with crowns. Now, when you think of a crown, what do you think of? Okay, a king, right, kingly power. Kings wear crowns. And so this beast, this nation, this kingdom that has horns with crowns tells us that this religious power also is combined with political power. And if you look at the Roman Church, that's what you find. The Roman Church is, the Pope is actually not just a religious leader, but he's actually the king of the Vatican. The Vatican itself has a postal system, and they have coins. They have coins which have the Pope's picture on there. And when you, again, look at the history of the Vatican, it has always been a religio-political power. It claims political power. It works with political organizations. It has been doing this for a long time. The Vatican is really a combination of a church and a state. The Vatican itself is not just a church. It is a state that has its own little country within the larger country of Italy. Vatican State is its own country. It is a church that is combined with a state. That's the very nature of the religio-political organization of the Roman Church. But the beast that we saw in Revelation 13, verse 11, this beast is different. This beast has horns that do not have any crowns, which indicates that this is a different kind of a nation, and that church and state are not together, that church and state are separate in the governmental structure of this nation. It is a nation that is not ruled by a king. It is a nation that is ruled by the people, separate from the king. At least that's the way it's supposed to be. That's what America is supposed to be all about. Now, this is something else that's very significant. It says that this nation has two horns like what kind of an animal? It says like a lamb. Right now, in the book of Revelation and in the New Testament, the lamb represents who? Jesus. That's right. Jesus Christ himself is the lamb. It's mentioned over and over again in the Bible. Now, this beast is not Jesus. I want to make that very clear. He's not the lamb. But he has two horns that are like a lamb in some way. They are lamb-like. They are Christ-like in certain of its features. Now, there's a very significant chapter that helps us to understand this in Matthew chapter 22. Keep your finger here in Revelation 13, and let's go back to Matthew chapter 22. And this is just fascinating. And it was announced a little while ago that I had the privilege one time in my life to go to the Pentagon and to give a Bible study. I was invited by a chaplain in the Pentagon in the year, I believe it was 2007, to speak inside the Pentagon. My associate Gilbert Navarro, he was there. His wife was there. And we went together. And it was amazing. And I had one chance to give one Bible study. And it wasn't in front of some people think that I actually addressed Congress. I really didn't do that. I was invited to the Pentagon, and I spoke inside a building where there's about 25,000 people that work there. But I was in one room where the chaplain had a Wednesday morning prayer breakfast for anyone that wanted to come. And there were probably 100 or 150 people that were there, Pentagon staff and different people. And I had a chance to give one Bible study by invitation, and guess what topic I picked? This one. I thought, you know, how many chances do I have to go to the Pentagon? I want to make this count. So I'm going to talk about something big, and it's going to be American prophecy. And I still remember looking at those people, and they were, you know, just staring at me, and I had my slides, and I went point by point by point, and I built my case, just like I'm doing right now. And one of the critical pieces of information that I gave was from Matthew chapter 22, which we're about to look at. Matthew chapter 22, this is very significant. In verse 15, 22:15, the Bible says that then went the Pharisees and they took counsel how they might entangle him in his talk. Here's a group of religious leaders that didn't like Jesus and they were trying to trap him. Can you imagine? Religious leaders trying to trap Jesus Christ. They had no idea who they were trying to trap. They didn't know that he had an IQ off the charts. But they thought that they could entangle him. So they sent some of their disciples, and they came to him and they said, "Master, we know that you are true," which was a lie. If they would have known that, they wouldn't be trying to trap him. I mean, he is true, but they didn't believe that. "And you teach the way of God in truth," which was a lie. If they would have believed that, they wouldn't have been trying to trap him. "Neither do you care for any man, and you do not regard the person of men. Tell us, therefore, what do you think? Is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar or not?" That was their trap question. They thought, okay, tell us. Is it lawful or right for us as Jews to pay our taxes and our tribute to Caesar, the Roman king? Now, this is what they thought. They thought they had him. They thought that if Jesus were to say, yes, you should pay your taxes to Caesar, then they'd go to the rest of the Jews and they'd say, look, how can you think this guy's the Messiah? He's telling us to pay taxes to Rome, our enemy. He can't be the Messiah. So they thought if he said that, they'd get him there. And then they thought, but if he says on the other side, if he says, no, don't pay your taxes to Caesar, then they would go to Pontius Pilate and to the Romans, and they'd say, here's a guy running around a Galilee and in Judea, and he's telling people not to pay their taxes to Rome. Get him. So they thought, we got him. There's no way he's going to get out of this. That's what they thought. But again, they had no idea who they were talking to. So Jesus, it says in the next verse, that Jesus, he perceived their wickedness. Jesus knows everything, doesn't he? He knows our hearts. He knows my heart. He knows your heart. And if there's any wickedness in our hearts, the Lord knows that. And this is the best time of ever for us to give up our wickedness and confess that and ask Jesus to change our lives. Wouldn't you agree? God sees everything. There's no wickedness that can escape his searching gaze. And Jesus perceived their wickedness, and he said to them, why are you tempting me, you hypocrites? And then he said, show me the tribute money. And they brought him a penny. Show me a penny. So they brought a penny to Jesus, and he lifted up that penny. And then he said to them, he said, whose is this image and superscription that's on this coin? Whose image is there on the coin? And they looked at the coin, and what did they say? They said, it's Caesar. That's right. It's Caesar's image that is on the coin. And then look at what Jesus said. Then saith he unto them, render therefore to Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and to God the things which are God's. Now, this is an amazing answer. And in fact, when they heard that, it says in verse 22, when they heard that, when they heard these words, they marveled and they left him and they went away. They had nothing to say. Now, look at this verse carefully. Caesar represents who? Caesar represents the government, the state. And Jesus said, render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. Caesar does have a certain sphere of influence, right? Caesar does have a certain legitimate authority to collect taxes and to enforce civil laws and to do certain things. That's the domain of Caesar. So Jesus said, give to Caesar what is Caesar's. And then he said, but give to God the things that are God's. Now, the things that belong to God are things like worship, prayer, things like that. Things that have to do with our conscience and obeying the Lord. Those are the things of God. And those things are separated. Caesar has a right to tell me what to do in some areas. Caesar has a right to tell me to pay my taxes. Now, I wish Caesar would tell me, you know, I could pay a little bit less. Wouldn't that be nice? But anyway, Caesar has a right to require us to do certain things. But there's a line that Caesar should not pass. Caesar has no right to tell me how to worship or anything to do with my relationship with God or my religious convictions. You know, this isn't in my notes, but I'll just tell you something. What's happening in our society concerning same-sex marriage, and state after state after state are approving same-sex marriage. You're aware of that, aren't you? You know, we live in a very scary time, and I don't think it's going to be long. I mean, it's very possible. I'm not a prophet, but it's very possible that in the very near future, the government may require every 501c3 organization, every church, to become gender inclusive. And if the government requires that, then what do we do? Let's say the government calls us all together for a meeting, and they say, you got to be at that meeting. Well, you know, the government has a certain right to command certain things. But if the government crosses a line and says, it doesn't matter what your religious convictions tell you, you should be gender inclusive in your pastors, who your pastors are, who your teachers are. And if they do that, and if they encroach into the area of our conscience and our religious convictions, I mean, I believe people have a right to do what they want to do. You know, if people want to live a certain way, it's their right. But the government doesn't have the right to tell me to violate my conscience when it comes to my convictions about what the Bible says. And if that time ever comes, I tell you, we need to take a stand, and it's called civil disobedience. You ever heard of that? Civil disobedience, where we say, no, we can't do that because our conscience tells us that we need to follow the Bible. Caesar has a right to do some things, but it should not cross the line in the area of the conscience and of the soul. Now, this is very significant because what Jesus is saying right here in this verse is that Caesar's domain is over here and the things of God are over there. He is separating government from religion. That's what Jesus Christ is doing. That's what the Lamb is doing. Jesus is the Lamb. He's the Lamb of God. And that's what he's doing. And here's an interesting part of my slide. I like the way that makes that. I'll do that again. I think that's pretty cool. This is our technology for you. See the fireworks, you know, America. Right. And right there you see the Bill of Rights. See that? The Bill of Rights. Now, do you know what the First Amendment is in the United States Constitution? We should all know this. We should know this. First Amendment of the United States Constitution says that Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. What this is saying is that Congress has a sphere of influence. But when it comes to enforcing religion or religious beliefs, back off. Congress has no right to be in that domain. The First Amendment of the Bill of Rights separates Caesar from the things of God. It separates government from religion. That's what it does right there. And that principle came from who? It came from Jesus Christ. It came from the Lamb who said, "Give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's." See that? That principle is enshrined in the very heart of the government of the United States. And the Bible says that this beast coming up out of the earth would have two horns like a lamb. It would have lamb-like horns, and that is the principle of Jesus Christ. And I tell you, we need to understand these things. Not only in the light of what's happening with same-sex marriages, but especially when it comes to the mark of the beast, which is what we will be studying about this afternoon. We need to be very, very clear on these things. Now, the scripture says that he would have those two horns. He would separate government and religion like Jesus taught, but eventually the Bible says that he will change. He will go through a transition, and he will eventually speak like a what? He will speak like a dragon. That's right. And ultimately, the dragon, the ultimate dragon, is Satan. Ultimately. And the dragon uses force. The dragon uses force. That's what's going to happen when the mark of the beast is enforced by law. We're going to be required by government to violate our consciences concerning our relationship with God. And government will have crossed the line. And God wants a people to be ready to stand up and to say, no, I cannot go along with that. I'll pay my taxes, yes, but I won't do that. I won't do that. Now, let's keep going. Let's go back to Revelation 13. Revelation 13 tells us, now this is very significant. Now we're going to get, you know, we talked about Revelation 13 sputtering and smoking. Well, let's move on right to today. Where are we right now in prophetic history? In verse 12, it tells us that this second beast, this nation, will exercise all of the power of the first beast before him. And he will cause the earth and them who dwell therein to worship, here's worship, to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. Now we have two beasts, right? We have the first beast, which is the Roman church, which has crowns, which is a church state combined. That's what the Vatican is. Vatican state. It's a church state combined. And then we have the second beast, which is the greatest political power on earth. We have the greatest, the most powerful religious power on earth in the first beast. And the second beast is the most powerful political power on earth today. Isn't that true? The Roman church is the most powerful religio-political church on the planet. And the United States is the most powerful political nation on earth, in spite of its problems, and we have all kinds of problems. But this verse, in verse 12, says that this second beast here, right up here, is going to cooperate with and promote the worship of the first beast. Are you following me? That's what the text says. That somehow the two of them are going to be working together. Not only that, but it also says that the second beast will set up an image of the first beast. In verse 7, at the end of verse 14, it tells us that he will say to them who dwell upon the earth that they, the people of the earth, should make an image to that first beast who had the wound by a sword and did live. Verse 15 says he has power, the second beast has power to give life to the image of the first beast, that the image of the first beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. So the second beast sets up an image of the first beast. Now think about this. The first beast has crowns. It is a church state combination. That's the first beast. The second beast has two horns that are separate like a lamb, but they have no crowns. The second beast is a political nation where the church and the state are separate based on the principle of Jesus Christ, which is enshrined in the First Amendment of the United States Constitution. Are you following me? So the first beast is the church and the state combined. The second beast is the church and the state are supposed to be separate. And prophecy says that the second beast is going to set up an image of the first beast. Now, what's an image? If you look in a mirror, what do you see? An image. If you go out on a lake, on a boat, and you look over and you see, you know, if the water's calm, you look down, you see an image. In the beginning, the Bible says God made man, how? In his image. Which means an image is a reflection. It's a reflection of an original. That's what an image is. And so here's the first beast, church and state combined. Second beast, church and state are separate. And in order for the second beast to set up an image or a reflection of the first beast, what needs to happen with that second beast? That's right. The church and the state, the division needs to break down. And they need to come together so that the church and the state are united and the government encroaches in the domain of conscience. And if that happens, if church and state come together, then an image is set up. An image of the first beast. In other words, America is going to walk in the footsteps of Rome. That's what prophecy is telling us. And not only that, but when that time finally comes, prophecy says that during a global crisis, the second beast will not only break down those two horns and speak like a dragon, but then it will use force. It'll use tremendous force to come down on those who don't agree. And the scripture says that he will cause all, which is force, small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead. And that's what I'll talk about this afternoon, when that mark is finally enforced. Now, let's just put the pieces together I did that last night. We talked about the beast. I put all these pieces together, remember? There was at least 11 pieces of information, of intelligence information from the Bible put on the screen about that first beast. And we identified that first beast as the Roman Church, based on history and based on prophecy. And now, if you look, if you put the pieces together, let me ask you, how many nations are there that have come up out of a wilderness area? Not out of the sea of multitudes of people, that have come up out of the earth down near the end of time, that have a separation, two horns without crowns, based on the principle of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, separating government and religion, who will eventually speak like a dragon and who is cooperating big time with the first beast. How many nations are there in this world right now that fit these prophetic details? Now, what I did in Washington, D.C., or in the Pentagon, when I was in the Pentagon, I put all these pieces together, and then I looked at that crowd of military leaders and people that worked in the Pentagon, and I looked at them. And just like last night when I talked about the beast, I looked at the crowd and I said, you know where I'm going with this, remember that? I said, how many nations fit all these points? And people were nodding their head. We can see it. Well, it's the same thing with the second beast. When I presented this at the Pentagon and I looked at these military officials, I said, how many nations are there in the world right now that fit every prophetic detail of Revelation 13? And you know what I saw? When I looked at these Pentagon brass, I looked at them, some of them with their, you know, medals on them. I looked at them and I said, how many nations? And you know what I saw? I saw heads going like this. Heads right out there. Because they knew. The information is there. And they knew. There's only one nation that fits this scenario. Only one. And it is the United States of America. Now, I've got a little more to do before we wind this up. Let me show you some very significant pieces of information. Just a couple months ago, the Huffington Post ran an article, and the title was Republicans Sink to a New Low by Stalling a Well-Deserved Resolution Honoring Pope Francis. There were some Republicans that were saying, no, I don't think we ought to do this. I don't think we as a nation should be honoring the Pope. And this particular article said, you know, that those Republicans were not in the majority. And it's interesting, when you read that article, and here's the whole article, or at least part of the article, I showed a picture of Pope Francis, and it says here that Ronald Reagan was probably rolling over in his grave when the news that conservatives in the House of Representatives are having a difficult time passing a resolution to honor Pope Francis. Considering the Gipper, referring to Reagan, his relationship with the Pope, with Pope John Paul II, and how this was viewed as a holy alliance, it's odd that those who revere Reagan should resist this resolution to honor the Pope. Now, if you were to click this link right here, it was an active link in this article, The Holy Alliance, and this came out, this was July 31, 2014. When you click that link, it brings you to another page showing you the front cover of Time Magazine, an older issue of Time Magazine, when Reagan was alive. And the title there says, Holy Alliance, How Reagan and the Pope Conspired to Assist Poland's Solidarity Movement, and to Hasten the demise of Communism. And this is showing how the Vatican and the United States worked together to bring communism down. And so this article saying, look, you know, those that reverence Reagan, why aren't they doing what Reagan did? Reagan had a strong relationship with the Vatican. Now here's a very interesting picture. When Pope John Paul II died, you've probably seen this. His funeral was a big funeral. And I'm not trying to, you know, I'm not talking about individual people. Their destiny is in the hands of God. God makes those decisions. But I'm dealing with issues, big issues when it comes to prophecy. And you probably have seen this picture. When John Paul II died, here he is lying in state, and here is Bill Clinton, and here's President Bush, and here the older senior, And here is President Bush. He was a former president. At this time, it was his son, President George Bush. And here is his wife. And they are all in front of this casket, right in front of the casket. And they are kneeling. They're on their knees in front of the casket of Pope John Paul II. Now, I want to tell you that America has come a long way in order for presidents to kneel at the foot of a casket of a pope. A long way. When Kennedy came up for election, remember, there was a huge stir among Americans about whether we wanted to have a Catholic president. But then Kennedy, you know, he made a statement and he said, I promise you, if I'm elected to the president of the United States, I will put the Constitution of the United States and the principles of America first above my religion. That's what he said. And that was one of the big reasons why he was elected. But I tell you, we've come a long way. We've come a long, long way. Protestant America, with its roots in Scripture and with its roots in separation of church and state and with its roots in a knowledge of history, of what has happened in Europe and the founding of this country, we have come a long way, and now we are rapidly moving toward honoring the first beast, just as Bible prophecy predicts that this is going to happen. Are you following me? Here's another article that came out in the Christian News Network not too long ago. There's a picture of Pope Francis and a whole host of Protestants, including television preachers. And the article, this came out July 3rd, 2014 in Christian News, and the article says, TV preachers glowingly describe meeting with the Pope to tear down the walls of division. The divisions between Protestants and Catholics, the division is coming down. The walls are coming down. This is very, very interesting. You see a number of leaders up there, Kenneth Copeland, James Robinson, two religious leaders in Northeast Texas, known for drawing huge crowds. They met with the Pope, it says, in an effort to work toward tearing down the walls of division between Catholics and Protestants. I took that, see where it says share on there? I don't think Martin Luther would have known anything about that. But I shared this article on my Facebook page. I have a Facebook page. It's a public page now. And I shared this article, and I have never gotten as big a response to anything I've ever posted as I did when I posted that article. It's amazing. Here it says, look on the bottom here, that article, there were over 17,000 people who watched it, who read it. And they shared it with all kinds of people. It says here there were 235 different people who shared that article posted on my page. And who knows how many other of those 235, how many of those shared it? And how many of those shared it? And how many of those shared it? And those shared it. Who knows how many people shared it? I don't know. But I'm showing you this for a reason. And the reason that I'm telling you this is to show you that there's a whole lot of people out there, Seventh-day Adventists and others, who are realizing that something is happening big time in this world. And that article and all the response to that article showed me that there's a whole lot of people that are listening to what God is saying in His Bible, in the book of Revelation. That when that mountain, Revelation 13, is smoking and sputtering, there's a whole lot of people who don't want to be like Harry Truman, who are recognizing that prophecy is being fulfilled in front of our eyes. The buzz is going on. And I hope that as a result of this talk this morning, that you will enter into that buzz. In other words, that you'll realize that something's going down. Something's happening big time. You know, in the days of Jesus, when the Jewish people, were there in the time of Christ, prophecy was being fulfilled right in front of their eyes with Jesus born in Bethlehem and his public ministry. But there was a whole host of them. They just totally were out to lunch. They completely missed it. Now, there were others that realized prophecy is being fulfilled. This is the long-awaited for Messiah. This is the one we've been waiting for all this time. They realized that, while others, among God's chosen people, among others, they missed it entirely, didn't they? They were just totally out to lunch. And so my question to you is, where are you? Are you among those that are just out to lunch, that just don't realize what's going on? Or are you among the people that recognize that prophecy is being fulfilled right in front of our eyes and that Jesus Christ is getting ready to come? He's getting ready to come. He came once, 2,000 years ago. Some saw it, some didn't. Some accepted him, some didn't. He's getting ready to come again. He's getting ready to come again. And his word is being fulfilled right in front of our eyes. And I tell you, the sooner the better, from my perspective. I want to go home. I want to get out of here. I don't want to live in a world that's full of terrorism and natural disasters and, where right is seen as wrong and wrong is seen as right and everything's upside down and there's just all kinds of craziness going on. I want to get out of here. I want to go up there and leave this planet. The Bible says the time is at hand. The time is at hand. I think this is my last slide. Revelation 13, 9, which is right in the middle of that chapter, Revelation 13, that we're studying about the first beast, about the second beast, about the second beast working with the first beast, and how they're coming together and getting ready to enforce the mark. That's the last step in the drama, which we'll talk about this afternoon. Right in the middle of that chapter, in verse 9, right in the center, there's 18 verses in Revelation 13, and the middle verse, verse 9, is Jesus Christ injecting this thought. He says, if anyone has an ear, let him hear. When prophecy is happening in front of our eyes, we need to hear and listen and understand that this is happening. Revelation chapter 3, verses 19 to 22, is Jesus' counsel to the church, to the Laodicean church. And he says, be zealous and repent. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne. Sit with me on my throne. He who has an ear, let him hear. I tell you, this is a wow verse. Jesus says in this verse that if we have an ear, and if we hear, and if we overcome, and I interpret that to mean overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil through his power. And we can't do it on our own. We need Jesus' power. But if we, through Jesus' power, rise above the ways of this world and overcome sin, we've got to overcome sin. Either sin's going to overcome us, or we're going to overcome it through the power of Jesus Christ. Now's the time to cut loose, to be earnest, to repent, to give up the wicked ways of this world, to say, no, I'm not going to follow Satan anymore. I'm not going to follow his ways. I'm not going to follow this wicked world. I'm going to take a stand for my Lord. And Jesus says, if we're willing to do that, he says, we're going to end up where? We're going to end up sitting with him on his throne. We can't even imagine that. I just want to get up there. I just want to get up there. Jesus says that if we're on his side all the way, we're actually going to sit with him on his throne. Now, exactly what all that means, we'll find out. But it means a lot. God has a big plan for you. He has a big plan for your life. When I look at you, one by one, look at your eyes. God has a big plan for you and for me. A big plan. It's bigger than anything that we can imagine. Now is the time for us to take a stand, to follow Jesus, to give him our entire lives. In the 1860s, there was a civil war in this country. Many of you, I'm sure, have read about it. One of the big issues was slavery, the North against the South against the North. It was a bloody battle on American soil. Abraham Lincoln, who was our president at that time in the North, was once asked this question. He was asked, somebody said to him, Brother Lincoln, do you think that God is on our side in this battle? And Abraham Lincoln, who was one of our best presidents, long time ago, he is reported to have responded this way. He said, "I'm not so concerned if God is on our side or not." He said, "My biggest concern is whether we are on his side." Good answer. Good answer. And so as we close, I just want to appeal from me to you. And it's not just me to you. It's the Lord through me. I believe that. That's really what ministers are all about. You know, faithful ministers, if we really are faithful ministers, we are channels, God's voice through the pastor to your heart. And I believe Jesus is talking to you. He loves you. He loves all of us. He paid the ultimate price. The greatest Statue of Liberty is not in New York Harbor. The greatest Statue of Liberty is the place where Jesus Christ died for you and for me, to give us freedom, to set us free from sin, to forgive our sins, to change our lives, and to give us power to do what's right and to live for God. To live for God. That's what it's all about. So I appeal to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to give your heart to Jesus 100%. Don't hold back anything. If you'll do that, it's the best decision you'll ever make. You'll never be sorry, especially when you get up there. You'll be really glad. So let's bow our heads and let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, what a mighty message that's in your word, in your book. Prophecies being fulfilled right in front of our eyes. The first beast is here. The second beast is here. The two horns are still here, but they're breaking down. And the first beast and the second beast are working together, just like prophecy predicts. And it won't be long until the crisis hits and the final fulfillment of the mark of the beast will be here. And Lord, we need to be ready for that mark. We can't get ready when the mark comes. We need to be ready when the mark comes so we can stand for Jesus. Please be with everyone here. Bless those that are watching on the social media stream. Help us all, Lord, to put you first, to love you, to appreciate your grace, your love, your suffering, your cross, and to be among that group that have ears to hear and are standing up for you on your side in these last days. In Jesus' name we pray.